I'm Teresa Caraggio, and this is Third Paradigm. My topic today is Jesus, rebel or imperialist? And it's going to be a long post because at the end, I'm going to be reading a 9-page paper that I once wrote that is probably the most scholarly thing that I've ever done. And this was after I left graduate school. So my topic is looking at Josephus and the War of the Jews and his use of the term in Greek that is translated rebel there, and the same word that's translated as robber in the Gospels. My premise is further that Josephus is the author of the Gospels, and this is something that I've worked with Joe Atwill on, but that isn't even necessary to be making this point, because at the same time these two things were written, and the same word would have been used one way or the other. The reason that I put so much work into this is because I'm trying to prove a point that goes contrary to 2,000 years of Bible scholarship, but which would have been known to the people at the time. And in order to do that, I felt that I needed to make sure that I had every I dotted and T crossed. First, I'd like to put this in context. Why is it so important? When there are so many wonderful, sincere people who use Christianity or Judaism as their way of doing good in the world, why do I want to mess with that? To answer that, I need to go back to the previous episodes where I talked about the book that I had in process that was called A House for the Soul in the Land Beyond Faith. And I got many wonderful responses to that, including from Mary, who said, "Am I the only one who really wants this book to be written?" Especially the questions. So what are the big questions? The very first and most important question is, what's my true relationship to you? Are we equals, or am I superior to you? And this is no matter who it is. This is even if you have one person in history or the current day or in the future. If you say, well, some people are born psychopaths, and you say, well, I'm superior to them. Once you've accepted that there is hierarchy, there's a pyramid and you are somewhere in it. And that means that you get to accept your superiority, but you also are then confirming that there are people superior to you. And that's the trick that ties us into empire thinking. So what I'm trying to do is say there are only two sides. There's empire and sovereignty. And if we are equal, I need to reject anything that gives me superiority because it's always a trick. It's always a trick that is used for me to give authority away from myself to someone else. So morality supersedes religion, and the morality is key to, are we equal or are we a hierarchy? This paper is based on a Greek word that can be translated alternately as robber or rebel. I have no hope of pronouncing that word, so please go to the Substack version, and that way you can actually see it, and I'll just be substituting the Greek word. And there's another reason to make sure and go to Substack and subscribe. YouTube keeps warning me that I can't be trusted with powerful things like links that actually work in my descriptions or the ability to pin comments. So just in case you lose access, it's good to be connected over Substack. Jesus, rebel or imperialist, robbers in the Gospels. According to scholars, the Gospels were first written down just after Judea's armed insurgency was defeated in the bloody siege of Jerusalem. In stark contrast to the times, the Gospel life of Jesus depicts a bucolic, pastoral setting with no mention of revolution. This makes it difficult to discern the author's position on the most pressing and controversial issue of the day, the right of national sovereignty or the divine right of empire. In this paper, we'll examine a clue in the gospel's view of the rebels, the Greek word which is commonly translated as robbers or thieves. First, we'll look at how robber was used in the War of the Jews by Josephus. Then we'll compare it to three examples from Jesus' life: a den of thieves, arrested like a robber with clubs and swords, and the good thief, bad thief. Finally, from the parables, we'll look at thieves and robbers used by the Pharisee in the temple, with the Good Samaritan, and related to the Good Shepherd. In these, we can discern how the authors of the Gospels viewed the insurgency against Rome as voiced by the person of Jesus. The translations used for the Gospels will be the Interlineal, NASB, NIV, the Complete Gospels, and Willis Barnstone's New Covenant. The question we'll be asking is whether the Greek word should be translated robber or rebel. To the Jesus Seminar, this is an old debate, judging from their use of the word rebel in three of the references in the Complete Gospels, and that is an international conference of Bible scholars that I attended for many years. However, I would like to apply the translation consistently to all the examples and to delve into the implications, particularly in discerning the gospel's position on the Judeans' right to revolt against Rome. Robbers in the War of the Jews. Paul Meyer writes, "Most historians write with some bias, and Josephus especially so. His principal prejudices, aside from a lofty appreciation of himself, 1. Jews have a proud and cultured history, as well as the highest form of religious belief. And 2. Romans, however, now enjoy God's favor because of the apostasy and villainy of the Jewish zealot leaders and their insurrectionary followers, whom Josephus regularly styles as bandits or brigands." This styling as bandits or brigands is translated in War of the Jews as robbers. The word zealot is used 62 times and Sicarii is used 20. Either sedition or seditious is used 126 times. And now Sicarii was the short dagger that were used by the zealots to assassinate the people who were betraying them at large conferences. So if you take Judas Iscariot and then transpose two letters, it becomes Judas the Sicariot, who was one of the founders of the zealots. And then I list various quotes from War of the Jews in which Josephus uses robber. "For that it was a seditious temper of our own that destroyed Jerusalem, and that they were the tyrants among the Jews who brought the Roman power upon us. When we speak so passionately about the tyrants or the robbers, or sorely bewail the misfortunes of our country, let him indulge my affections herein, though it be contrary to the rules for writing history. By this means Herod subdued these caves and the robbers that were in them. When Herod was informed of this insurrection, he came to the assistance of the country immediately and destroyed a great number of the seditions. Felix took Eleazar the arch robber and many that were with him alive, when they had ravaged the country for 20 years together, and sent them to Rome. But as to the number of the robbers whom he caused to be crucified, and of those who were caught among them, and whom he brought to punishment, they were a multitude not to be enumerated. When the country was purged of these, there sprang up another sort of robbers in Jerusalem, which were called Sicarii. A company of deceivers and robbers got together and persuaded the Jews to revolt and exhorted them to assert their liberty, inflicting death on those that continued in obedience to the Roman government. And then I have a table where I went through each book of War of the Jews and counted how many times the word robbers, zealots, sicarii, and sedition or seditious were used. The use of robbers reaches its peak of 25 in Book 2, and then drops off precipitously in Book 3 when Josephus describes his own part in the war. Robber is then used admiringly and prefaced with private, for the Jews then made sallies out of the city like private robbers. And now Vespasian was plainly irritated at the great subtlety of this stratagem and at the boldness of the citizens of Jotapata. They made fresh sallies upon the Romans, together with all such contrivances as robbers make use of. Total references to the rebels also build to a penultimate peak of 83 in Book 2, drop to 9 in Book 3 when Josephus enters the scene, and bounce up to an ultimate peak of 93 in Book 4 after he's declared God to be on the Roman side. Book 4 has 51 out of 62 references to the zealots. In the previous books, before Josephus joins the Romans, there's only one reference to zealot. The Sicarii don't come into their own until after the fall of Jerusalem, in the last book of Masada, with 15 mentions out of 20. It seems that Josephus used euphemistic terms, robbers, tyrants, or fond of innovations, while he's part of the insurgency. After he turns cloak, he calls them by the names they call themselves, but with scathing regard, both for their mission and for their tactical incompetency. A den of thieves or a cave of crooks. So in this, I'm looking at the gospel references to that same word, and the different versions I'm using of the Bible are the NIV Study Bible, which is the New International Version, the New Covenant, which is translated directly from the Greek, which is the earliest of any verbal or written version from what the scholars have found. And this is done by Willis Barnstone, who's a wonderful translator. And then the Complete Gospels, which are done by, edited by Robert Miller. And this is part of the Jesus Seminars, where there's all different translators who are involved. From the NIV, Mark 11:17, "And as he taught them, he said, 'Is it not written, My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations, but you have made it a den of robbers.'" And now the New Covenant says a cave of robbers, that there are other ones that say a hideout for crooks. In each example, the Greek word is den, cave, or hideout, and the other Greek word is robbers, thieves, or crooks. In Josephus, however, caves are a favorite hideout of the Jewish rebels. War of the Jews. "But when Herod had reached Sepphoris, he hastened away to the robbers that were in the caves, who overran a great part of the country." Now these caves were in the precipices of craggy mountains and could not be come at from any side. So he let down the most hardy of his men in chest and set them at the mouths of the dens. Now these men slew the robbers and their families, and when they made resistance, he sent in fire upon them and burnt them. By this means Herod subdued these caves and the robbers that were in them. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the sellers who make the temple a den of thieves are not doing anything out of the ordinary that could be described as theft. It's more likely that this use of the Greek word describes the rebels who occupied the temple during the siege. The New Covenant mentions by name the two high priests killed by the rebels during this time between the altar and the sanctuary, which is the detail by which the Gospels are dated by scholars. Swords or clubs against the robber or the rebel. From Mark 14:48, as against a robber, come ye forth with swords and clubs to arrest me. And then other translations, as against a thief. In Luke 22:52, am I leading a rebellion that you have come with swords and clubs? As against a robber came ye with swords and clubs. Have you come out with swords and clubs as though you were apprehending a rebel? In describing Jesus' arrest, all versions give the literal translation as robber in Mark and Matthew. Both the interlinear and Willis Barnstone's New Covenant, which is translated directly from the Greek, stick to robber in Luke's version. But the NIV and Complete Gospels move to the interpretive translation with leading a rebellion and apprehending a rebel. This interpretation makes logical sense. A common thief would be apprehended in the act or at home where they're likely to have stored the goods and would require no more than two soldiers. An insurgent would be met with an army expecting a clash. The good thief or the repentant rebel, from Mark 15:27. They crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. In the same way, the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him, and that's Matthew 27:44. They crucified two thieves with him. Then they crucified two rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left, and that's the Complete Gospels translation. From Luke 23:32, and were led also others, criminals, two with him to be killed. There they crucified him and the criminals. And one of the hanged criminals blasphemed him. The other, rebuking him, said, things worthy of what we did, we receive back. But this man nothing amiss did. We are getting justice, since we are getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing improper. The Complete Gospels break with the literal translation in Matthew and Mark, using rebels for those crucified with Jesus. Again, this makes sense. From Josephus, we know that the number of the robbers, rebels, whom he caused to be crucified were a multitude not to be enumerated. In Luke, a different word is used for those crucified, which is translated as criminal. The rebels, however, would only be criminal under Roman law. The use of this term signifies the author's Roman bias, because other Jews would not call them criminal. The Judeans and the Romans are both armed enemy combatants whose actions have lethal intent. The only difference is that one side is fighting for the right of self-rule, and the second is fighting for the right to rule over the other, sovereignty versus supremacy. Luke calls those fighting for sovereignty criminals, and calls those fighting for supremacy soldiers, even though the latter is killing captives and their families by slow torture rather than in combat. Luke's viewpoint is pro-imperial. Luke confirms this view when one of the crucified says, we are getting justice since we are getting what we deserve, but this man has done nothing improper. Jesus does not contradict him and say that crucifixion isn't just and no one deserves to be tortured. He doesn't say that the cause of Judean sovereignty is right. His answer is that today he'll be with him in a shaded garden, the literal meaning of the Greek phrase translated paradise. Jesus thereby canonizes the rebel who says that Jesus was never one of them, confirming that Jesus never opposed Roman authority. Crucifixion isn't wrong per se, according to Jesus, but they have the wrong guy. Jesus also uses a Greek trope to promise the rebel who exonerates him that he'll be with him tonight in a Greek concept of heaven. Either Jesus was speaking in Greek while being crucified as a Judean rebel, or the author of Luke is driving home the point that Jesus was a Hellenist Jew, not a nationalist. When Jesus dies, the Roman officer declares, "This man was completely innocent." Innocent of what? In Josephus's use of the Greek term, he is innocent of rebellion against the Roman Empire. In the temple, in the garden, and on the cross, Jesus has denied 3 times that he's a rebel. There's a curious note in Wikipedia under the penitent thief. The apocryphal Arabic infancy gospel calls the two thieves Titus and Dumachus. Titus, of course, is the general, son of Vespasian, who's just put down the Judean rebellion at the time of the gospel's writing. And he is the one who says that Jesus is innocent. Separating sheep from goats and thieves from robbers. The 3 remaining references to thieves or robbers in the canonical Gospels are the Pharisee in the temple, the Good Samaritan, and the Good Shepherd. From Luke 18:11, the Pharisee stood up and prayed silently as follows, "God, I thank you that I am not like everybody else, thieving." In Luke's account of the Pharisee, a different Greek word is translated as thieving in the complete Gospels. However, the interlinear translates it as rapacious and the New Covenant as grasping, indicating a different meaning. The commandment on theft itself uses a different Greek word. Neither of these words seem to indicate insurgency. From Luke 10:30, this fellow was on his way from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him, beat him up, and went off, leaving him half dead. Which of these, in your opinion, acted like a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? So the story of the Good Samaritan is like the search for a moderate Muslim. It implies that goodness or moderation is not the norm among that population. During the Judean revolt, there were Samaritans who joined the cause, becoming robbers or rebels. Simultaneous to the mere 47-day siege of Jotapata, in which Josephus surrendered, Samaritan rebels gathered on Mount Gerizim. Vespasian dispatched a Roman legion, which killed 11,600 under the assumption they must be up to no good. In the decades prior, Pontius Pilate was recalled to Rome for using excessive force in persecuting a Samaritan movement and their leader, possibly messianic, on Mount Gerizim. Although the Judeans and the Samaritans may have differed in rituals and place of worship, independence from Rome seemed to be a common cause among them, and perhaps the reason they are disparaged in the New Testament. When the man falls into the hands of the rebels, they strip him. The Oxford etymologist tells us that robber comes from the same root as robe. In Strip Them Naked or The Robber Disrobed, Anatoly Lieberman describes the custom. A defeated enemy or a prisoner of war may be killed or stripped of everything he wears before and sometimes instead of being murdered. Reports gloat over the details. Marauders search for good clothes and valuables on the battlefield and care little for the indignity with which they are treating corpses. But it was the ability to humiliate the survivors that gave the greatest joy to the winning party. So rather than an innocent victim of robbers, the man may have been a wealthy patriarch or an informant to the Romans exposed by the rebels. There are numerous references to clothing or lack thereof in the New Testament. The wedding garment, the seamless garment, and the curious incident at Gethsemane of the youth who slips away naked because they grab his robe. Robes were the symbol of wealth, without which a person was just like everyone else. Robes were also the symbol of power for the priest, which the rebels usurped or reclaimed, depending on your point of view. From this history of the word, Josephus's euphemism is apt. The rebels were robbers in stripping the toparchies of their Roman-conferred authority and the spoils of collaboration. And then last, John 10:1. I tell you the truth, the man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. Therefore Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have abundance. Also from Lieberman, another way of describing how victims are divested of their clothing is to liken them to sheep and to say that they are shorn or fleeced. Parts of the New Testament, translated by Bishop Wulfilla in the 4th century, have come down to us. It may be that Gothic Wilwan Rob is related to Wulla Wool. If so, we have a good parallel to the English of fleece. The etymon, that is the ultimate source of spoil, from which we have despoil and spoils, is the Latin spolium, skin stripped from an animal, booty. He goes on to link the word flay to fleecing and robbing. The shepherd, of course, would have the right to shear, skin, or butcher the sheep that were his. He's not raising the sheep as pets. If the sheep refused to be fleeced, they would deserve to be killed and flayed. The Arabic infancy gospel says that Titus, the righteous thief in the crucifixion story, kept Joseph and Mary from being robbed during their flight into Egypt, which would have been the year of the Roman census tax that sent them to Bethlehem. This same year, 6 of the Common Era, is the 10th year of the rule of Archelaus, when Josephus's father, Matthias, is born to his grandfather, Joseph. However, his family inherits their royal blood and alliance with the high priesthood through the maternal lineage. It was because of this census tax that Judas the Galilean and Zadok the Pharisee founded the Zealots and the Fourth Philosophy. They said that the tax was the first step to slavery, in effect branding the sheep to be fleeced. They also began the Sicarii, a word that my automatic spell check wants to change to Iscariot. While the compliant Judeans were returning to their birthplaces, the robber rebels were using the displacement to waylay the collaborators. Possibly the residents of poor towns also refused hospitality to the wealthy, who were slumming reluctantly among them. The Gospels say that Joseph and Mary returned from Egypt when word came that they were dead. But Herod was dead before the census, and the other rulers were still alive and kicking. Who died? Judas and Zadok were executed with their students, but the deaths of the two teachers sparked 6 decades of insurgency. However, the census attributed to Herod that marks the birth of Christ coincides with the birth of the Zealot revolt. On the other hand, the birth of the written Gospels is coincident with the siege of Jerusalem and the death of the Zealot movement. While we have no record of the Fourth Philosophy, Josephus names the heresy they continue to spread in Alexandria, even after Jerusalem and Masada fell, and he states their doctrines as to assert their liberty, to esteem the Romans to be no better than themselves, and to look upon God as their only Lord and Master. Since then, I've also found that Paul Meyer, the expert on Josephus, believes that Zadok, or Zadok, the Pharisee, is the one who founded the Sadducees. And in my conversations with the Jehoshaphat, who is the Hasidic rabbi from other of my episodes, he said, oh, the Sadducees, they really weren't political. Their difference was that they rejected the Torah. So in rejecting the Torah, it would be rejecting the genealogical right to rule of the Jews. To continue, when the Jews of reputation turned the rebels over to the Romans, Josephus writes that their courage, or whether we ought to call it madness or hardiness in their opinions, everybody was amazed at. For when all sorts of torments and vexations of their bodies that could be devised were made use of to them, they could not get any one of them to comply so far as to confess or seem to confess that Caesar was their Lord. But they persevered in their own opinion in spite of all the distress they were brought to, as if they received these torments and the fire itself with bodies insensible of pain, and with a soul that in a manner rejoiced under them. But what was most astonishing to the beholders was the courage of the children, for not one of these children was so far overcome by these torments as to name Caesar for their Lord. So far does the strength of the courage of the soul prevail over the weakness of the body. Now remember, Josephus hates the zealots, and so his testimony in this, when he considers them demon-possessed and that that's where their courage comes from, should be trusted at least in terms of the fact, not necessarily the interpretation. On which side is Jesus? Is he with those who assert their liberty, esteem the rulers to be no better than themselves, and look upon God as their only Lord and Master? Or is he with those who feel the insurgents are the thieves, taking what belongs by divine right to the rulers? This is the question on which the future of Christianity hangs. And that was what I wrote 15 years ago, but I would say now, this is the question on which the future of the world hangs, that it's not enough to say, oh, I'm not a believer. This is the mentality, the justification, the foundation for the entire right of some to rule over others. And it's something that we need to challenge and challenge in ourselves. We need to get that empire thinking out of our own systems and recognize that this is an original psyops. And while we're debunking the story of Jesus, it's important to note that this time of Christmas, 2,000 years ago, may have been the birth of the Christ, the one who actually said, the greatest power that the empire has of pain and fear and loss may not be real at all, that even children understood that. So for more on this, here is last year's Jesus is the OG PsyOps, and here is a playlist on scriptures and empire. Thank you for watching.